In the next, let's say, half an hour, I will try to describe some of unusual or exotic applications of flow cytometry in microbiology, or at least some of the applications in our research activity. Why do we refer as exotic applications? We know that flow cytometry was born for clinical applications using eukaryotic cells. Bacteria are smaller than eukaryotic cells, and they drop exactly close to the background, close to the noise of the instrument. There are many applications of a flow cytometry in microbiology, in aquatic microbiology, in environmental microbiology for the detection of virus, for example. However, the potential of flow cytometry is still largely unexpressed in areas different than the clinical and biomedical applications. But high processivity, multiparametric, and analytical precision are typical features of flow cytometry. For example, in food microbiology, we have application in winemaking, for example, or again in dairy production, or again in other fields of the microbiology in fish and animal farming, and so on. I'm a microbiologist, I work with lactic acid bacteria and probiotics. And so today I'll try to give you an overview of the applications of this strange application of flow cytometry in applied to lactic acid bacteria and probiotic, but not only. So in particolar, I will bring to you just sorry, just a second. I'll bring to you some example of application of flow cytometry to determine the activity of antimicrobials compound, to determine cell-to-cell metabolic interactions between the two microorganisms that are used for the production of the yogurt, and the flow cytometry for cell counting and the determination of the viability of a probiotic formulation. So let's start with the first examples. So application of flow cytometry to determine the cell sensitivity to toxic compounds, in particular in foodborne pathogens. The first application will be the monitoring of the activity of efflux pump, then the determination of the mechanism of action of the dipromazolin, that is an antibiotic produced by the genus Pseudomonas, and again the activity of resveratrol-derived monomers and dimers against foodborne pathogens, and finally a case study of Listeria monocytogenes and the efficacy of a mild heat treatment combined with the presence of terpenoids, molecule like carvacrol and timol. Let's start with the characterization of the activity of efflux pumps. The efflux pumps are membrane proteins that are present in all living organisms, so eukaryotic and prokaryotic cells. These proteins are involved in the active extrusion of a wide range of structurally dissimilar substrates from the cells. So once the cells understand that there is a toxic compound inside the cells, can activate such a kind of system to detoxify the cells from these toxic compounds. In particular, in this study, we characterize the efflux pump of Streptococcus thermophilus, that is a lactic acid bacterium, and is like model microorganisms in our lab. Efflux pump, here there is a figure that shows how the efflux pump can work and which kind of staining we can use to characterize the activity of the efflux pump. Basically, the efflux pump can work in presence of ATP. So if you stain a cell suspension with ethidium bromide, basically the ethidium bromide is recognized as a toxic compound, and in presence of ATP, cells can active extrude the ethidium bromide. And this is the case of non-stressed bacterial cells, and this is the case of stressed bacterial cells without ATP to be used for the extrusion for the pump out of these toxic compounds. And to characterize the activity of the efflux pump of Streptococcus thermophilus, we stain our cell suspension with cybergreen to distinguish cells from the background, from the noise of the instrument. And simultaneously, we stain cells with ethidium bromide. So this is the results before the addition of a carbon source to be used to produce ATP, and what happens after 30 minutes of incubation. As you can see, there is a decrease of the fluorescence of the ethidium bromide that reflect the extrusion of ethidium bromide from inside to outside the cells. And then to better characterize the activity of this efflux pump, we overexpressed the efflux pump in the strain called MIM-27. The strain MIM-20 was the type strain transformed just with the empty vector. And as you can see, in presence of ATP, of a carbon source, and then the ATP, after 15 minutes of incubation with the carbon source, we got two different populations in terms of fluorescence of the ethidium bromide. Conversely, when we overexpress the efflux pump, as you can see, we have just one single population after the incubation with the carbon source. So we can say that the efflux of the ethidium bromide is more efficient in when we can overexpress the efflux pump. And in particular, we have just one population rather than the two populations we had when we use the type strains. And basically, thanks to flow cytometry, we realized a phenotypic heterogeneity in terms of activity of this efflux pump in our type strains. And this could be due to different level of activity of the efflux pump in the two populations that we got after the efflux, or better, maybe a different level of the translation, transcription, and then translation of the efflux pump. And consider that these phenotypic heterogeneities is, we can see these phenotypic heterogeneities only thanks to flow cytometry, because, for example, you can monitor the efflux of the ethidium bromide also by a fluorometer, but only thanks to an analyzer, the analysis of flow cytometry, that is an analysis cell to cell, you can realize such a kind of phenotypic heterogeneity. Let's move to another application. The second application is the study on the activity of the promethazine. Promethazine is an antibiotic produced by Pseudomonas putida and is an antibiotic that is active against gram-negative and gram-positive bacteria. To figure out the mechanism of action of promethazine, we exposed our model organisms, microorganisms, Streptococcus thermophilus, to promethazine and to chlorhexidine as control, because chlorhexidine is a biocide with the cell membrane as target. And after exposure of the cells to promethazine, the cell suspension was stained simultaneously with the cybergreen and propidium iodide. The cybergreen has green fluorescence and is able to stain all the cells present in the cell suspension. Conversely, propidium iodide has a red fluorescence and is able to stain only those cells with the damaged membrane or dead cells. At the end of the staining, we got three different populations in terms of fluorescence. The first population in the gate G1 are the population with the only fluorescence of the cybergreen. The second population in G2 is the population that exhibit both fluorescence, red of the propidium iodide and green of the cybergreen. And the third population in G3 gate is the population that exhibit only the red fluorescence due to the high concentration of propidium iodide inside these cells. So we can define in G1 live cells, in G2 damaged cells, and in G3 dead cells. And the exposure of the cells after 60 minutes to promethazine determine an increase of the membrane permeability and the depth of the cells, as you can see if you compare the figure A and the figure C. And the increase of the number of events inside the gate 3 means an increase of the permeability of the membrane to the propidium iodide, so a higher level of damage at the level of the cell membrane. The promethazine acts like a biocide because it seems a bactericide activity that determine the death of the cells rather than the inhibition of the growth of the cells. And in collaboration of our colleagues of the Section of Chemistry and Biochemistry, we investigated the part of the promethazine involved in the antimicrobial activity. And simply, our colleagues removed different part of the molecule, one at a time, and we exposed Streptococcus thermophilus to different derived molecules without a part of the original molecule. The original molecule is the promethazine, and all the other derivatives lost a part of the molecule. And easily we figure out that two specific parts of the promethazines were involved in the induction of the membrane damages. Indeed, the exposure of the cells to the molecule number 5 and the molecule number 6 did not determine the death of the cells and the increase of the membrane permeability. Again, in collaboration of our colleague of the Section of Chemistry, we investigated the resveratrol and derived monomers and dimers and the activity of these molecules against foodborne pathogens. Why resveratrol? Basically because resveratrol is a natural compound and it is produced by plants to counteract the pathogen invasion and the invasion, for example, of microorganisms, bacteria, fungi or virus, for example. Therefore, these molecule are supposed to be active against fungi, virus, and bacteria. There are also recent reports on the combination of these molecules with the clinical antibiotics, where resveratrol and the molecule like resveratrol can act as inhibitor of the efflux pumps, allows the antibiotic to reach its target within the cells. So basically this molecule seems to be a method, let's say, to counteract the onset of the phenomenon of antibiotic resistance by giving, let's say, if possible, new life to antibiotics for which resistance have been developed. And I try to go faster in this part. Basically, we determine the minimal inhibitory concentration for the compounds that are highlighted in these slides, and we take into consideration the original molecule that was the resveratrol. And all these molecules were active, both monomers and dimers, were particularly active against Staphylococcus aureus as representative of gram-positive bacteria, but none of the molecules were active against Pseudomonas aeruginosa used as a reference, as a gram-negative reference. Then we increased the number of gram-positive microorganisms and gram-negative microorganisms to be tested against these molecules. And as you can see, the selected molecules were non-active against gram-negative bacteria, but were extremely active against all the gram-positive microorganisms we tested in our assay. And in particular, one of the most active molecules was the molecule number 15, as you can see from the MIC, so the minimal inhibitory concentration, and the MBC, the minimal bactericidal concentration values, for this molecule that is called the dehydrovinifrin. We exposed our Listeria monocytogenes strains in PBS to different concentration of the molecule number 15, in particular 10 and 100 microgram ml for 30 minutes at 37 degrees. And as always, as positive control, we use chlorhexidine. As I told you, chlorhexidine is a biocide with a cell membrane as target. And basically, after the staining with Cyto24 and propidiumiodide to assess the viability of the cell suspension after the exposure, we figure out that the antimicrobial activity, we figure out that the antimicrobial activity of the molecule number 15 was proportional to the concentration used. And as you can see, if we compare 10 with 100 microgram ml, the number of dead cells increase by increasing the concentration of the molecule. The 10 microgram ml, of the molecule number 15 only affect the viability of the cell suspension, but only marginally. And so in parallel, we determined the membrane potential of the same cell suspension. Why? Because the membrane potential is a very important parameter for the life of the cells. And as you can see in this figure, the membrane potential, if we refer to the control condition, the membrane potential of the cells exposed to 10 or 100 microgram ml of the molecule number 15 was completely compromised. So there was not membrane potential after the exposure of the cells at the lowest concentration of the molecule. In this case, we use gramicidine as a reference molecule because it is an antibiotic able to alter the membrane potential of the cells. and the analysis by the electronic microscope confirmed a loss of integrity of the membrane with a release of the intracellular content in those cells of Listeria monocytogenes treated, exposed to the molecule number 15. So these molecules can induce membrane depolarization, and it seems that the first effect of the exposure of the cells to this antimicrobial is the induction of depolarization of the cell membrane, then can induce the damages at the level of the cell membrane. Indeed, we can see a release of the intracellular content that reflect a damages at the level of the membrane and can induce several morphological changes. So by flow cytometry, beside the viability of the cell suspension, we could assess or at least have the first idea of the mechanism of action of these molecules that is a dimer of the resveratrol. Now we move to the case study of Listeria monocytogenes. Listeria monocytogenes is a pathogen, is an ubiquitous microorganism, and sometimes, unfortunately, associated to some food. And the aim of this study was the evaluation of the efficacy of an antimicrobial treatment to inactivate Listeria monocytogenes cells. And in particular, here we combined a mild heat treatment, so a treatment are at 50 or 55 degrees for 30 minutes, in combination with the exposure to thymol and carvacrol, that are these two molecules produced by plants. We determined the viability after the treatment at 50 degrees or 55 degrees. And also in this case, we combine the simultaneous staining of the cell suspension with cybergreen and propidium iodide. So again, three different populations, a population of alive, injured, and dead cells. And this is the distribution of the three populations of Listeria monocytogenes after the mild heat treatment. What happens if I combine the mild heat treatment in presence of, for example, the thymol? As you can see, if we compare the time, the condition of the treatment of Listeria monocytogenes only with 50 only at 50 degrees or 55 degrees, if we add the thymol, we increase the permeability of the cells to propidium iodide. And let's see what happens when we did the same at 55 degrees in presence of thymol. Of course, the efficacy of the treatment is high. This is what happens at 50 degrees in presence of carvacrol, at 55 degrees in presence of carvacrol, and then we combine the mild heat treatment in presence of two terpenes, thymol and carvacrol, and thymol and carvacrol at 55 degrees. But there is a big issue, and what's the problem? Because this is what happens after just the mild heat treatment. So it seems that most of the cells of Listeria monocytogenes, around 90% or 76% of the cells remain alive after such a kind of mild heat treatment. But if you try to cultivate these cells, you cannot cultivate these cells. So it seems that cells maintain their viability, but they lose completely their culturability. And this is a particular physiological state that is called BNC, viable but not culturable state. And this is a very critical state because cells cannot duplicate themselves on agar plate, but still remain alive and in particular metabolically active. So it is not completely understood when and how the mechanism of resuscitation of these cells, that, for example, can regain the ability to duplicate themselves after, for example, an exposure to another stress. So I think that it's a very critical point, because my feeling is that there is a need to reconsider protocol for assessment of sensitivity to a particular treatment, because after just the treatment at 50 or 55 degrees, I can conclude, okay, this teramonocytogenes is sensitive to such a kind of treatment. But this is completely not true. So let's move to another application, cell-to-cell interaction and bacterial physiology. So we change completely the context, because now we are talking about Streptococcus thermophilus and Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus. These are the two lactic acid bacteria that are used for the production of yogurt, and the interaction between these two microorganisms is known as mutualism or protocooperation. So both species have beneficial from the interaction. And in particular, the roads, Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus provides amino acid to Streptococcus thermophilus, and Streptococcus thermophilus provides carbon dioxide, pyruvate, and formate during the yogurt production, so during their growth in milk. Streptococcus thermophilus is the only lactic acid bacterium displaying urease activity. And urea is present in milk. And the urease activity of Streptococcus thermophilus determines the release of carbon dioxide and ammonia. In previous study, we demonstrated that the hydrolysis of urea and the release of ammonia can increase the intracellular pH of Streptococcus thermophilus, that is the lactic acid bacteria urease positive. And this increase of the intracellular pH positively affects all the enzymes, the activity of all enzymes involved in the glycolytic pathway. And the result is that the release of ammonia can determine a higher production of lactic acid. This seems quite a paradox, because it seems that to acidify, this acidogenic microorganism needs to alkalize its intracellular pH. So, beside the effect that urease activity and ammonia can have on the energetic metabolism of Streptococcus thermophilus, we try to understand, to figure out if the alkalization of the intracellular pH of Streptococcus thermophilus and if the ammonia that comes from hydrolysis of urea can, to some extent, modify and modulate the intracellular pH of Lactobacillus delbrueckii bulgaricus that share the same environment of Streptococcus thermophilus. So basically, we use carboxyfluoresein. And carboxyfluoresein is a non-fluorescent molecule that becomes fluorescent after the transport inside the cells. Once inside the cells, the carboxyfluoresein is cleaved by intracellular esterases, and the final product is a green fluorescent molecule. And the fluorescence of the carboxyfluoresein depends on, of course, esterase activity of the cells, but also depends on the intracellular pH. So high pH, high high fluorescence at alkaline pH, the fluorescence decreases when the pH decreases, so during the lactic acid production. And to understand if the ammonia from the urea hydrolysis of Streptococcus thermophilus can modify the intracellular pH of lactobacillus del gruppo Bulgaricus, we use a mixed population of Streptococcus thermophilus unstained and Lactobacillus del gruppo Bulgaricus stained with the carboxyfluorescein. After the addition of urea and the release of ammonia, we observed an increase of the extracellular pH, of course, but also an increase of the fluorescence of the population that corresponds to Lactobacillus del gruppo Bulgaricus, and this increase of the fluorescence corresponds to an increase of the intracellular pH. In this figure, we have the forward scatter on the x-axis and the fluorescence of the carboxyfluorescein on the y-axis. So a shift on the up of the figure reflects an increase of the intracellular pH of Lactobacillus del Brucki bulgaricus. So the ammonia that is released by the urease positive population can diffuse outside the cells of the urease positive cells and can modulate the intracellular pH of the urease negative microorganism. We move to the milk because the milk is the real environment of these two microorganisms. And in milk, we cannot see the increase of the intracellular pH that is this curve in red because the milk is buffered system, but what we got is that in presence of when we add to the milk urea, in the case of Streptococcus thermophilus, that is a urease positive microorganism, or we add ammonia, we could measure it. At the end of the incubation, just 15 minutes of incubation, we could measure an increase of the production of the lactic acid. And so we confirmed that urea and ammonia that comes from urea can boost the energetic metabolism of Streptococcus thermophilus. And similarly, we did the same with Lactobacillus del Brucki bulgaricus. We didn't add, of course, urea because Lactobacillus del Brucki bulgaricus is a urease negative microorganisms, but the addition of ammonia increased the lactic acid production also of Lactobacillus del Brucki bulgaricus. And then we mixed the cultures in milk. The addition of urea or the addition of ammonia determined the increase, the total lactic acid production of both species. And so the urease has an altruistic cooperative trait, and what we can say is that if we consider the mechanism, the regulation of the metabolism at three levels, we have three different levels of to control the energetic metabolism of microorganisms. The first is, of course, the gene expression, the second, the post-translational modification, and the third one, that is the case of urease activity, is an allosteric modulation. So this new role of this enzymatic activity that account 1% of the genome of Streptococcus thermophilus. And very quickly, because the time is over, the determination of the viability of a probiotic formulation, the gold standard for the enumeration of viable cells in microbiology is dilution and plating on agar medium. This medium is time consuming and we need the time at least 3-5 days before to get the results of dilution and plating. And moreover, there are not selective media, for example, to distinguish one species from one another in the case of a formulation, a complex formulation of probiotics, formulations that can encompass more than one species. So in this case, it's essential to assess the viability of the probiotic, because if we look at the definition of probiotic, probiotics are live microorganisms that, when administered an adequate amount, confer a health benefit on the host. So the determination of the viability is the quality check, the most important quality check of the probiotic formulation. And in 2015, we got this new protocol from the ISO 19344. That consider flow cytometry a tool to assess the viability of probiotics and fermented products. One of the protocol of the ISO 19344 is the combination, the staining, the simultaneous staining of a cell suspension with the Cyto24 and Propidium iodide. And we have, of course, the three different populations in terms of fluorescence. And but the protocol introduces new terms for these populations. So not colony forming unit, that is the measure and the results for dilution and plating, but active fluorescent unit for those cells that are only green, so they are considered alive. Damaged cells for those cells that have both fluorescence, green and red, and non-active fluorescence unit for those cells that have only red fluorescence due to the huge amount of propidium iodide inside of the cells. But the problem is that, of course, flow cytometry is not a taxonomic analysis, and so in a complex probiotic formulation that can encompass up to 8 different species, I cannot figure out, for example, the species in the viable population. So to overcome this issue that flow cytometry is not taxonomic, we selectively sorted the green and the red population, and we combine DNA extraction and qPCR assay to assess the relative abundance of the 8 species inside this probiotic formulation by using specific species-specific primer. And at the end, we determined in all these population the ratio of all the species in our probiotic formulation. Just to conclude with some pros and cons of flow cytometry, of course, is a rapid analysis with a very high accuracy. Of course, we can have information of those cells that are not culturable, but they are still viable in our sample, and is, of course, a very informative technique, because is an analysis at a single cell level, and of course is not a taxonomic approach. And flow cytometry is a fundamental support in our research activity, and I believe that we are only partially exploiting the potential of this technique. The markers, the staining available on the market allow to obtain a lot of information about the physiological and the metabolic state of the cells. The challenge, and this is my point of view, the challenge is to develop a staining protocol which can be strain specific, so can work for one strain but cannot work, for example, for another strain. I think that there is still a long way to go, and I have not entered into technical details, but if you have a curiosity or if you want more insight, do not hesitate to contact me. I would like to thank you, all of you, for your attention. And thanks again for inviting me.